Hello students, welcome for the day 2 live session. So I hope that all of you would have got your break. Let's then start students, just a confirmation from all of you, we can then start with our today's session. Nishank, Arvind, Anand Kumar, Nitesh, Satish, Chinna, Muthu, Lakshmi. Good morning, students. Good morning to all of you. Now, students, those who are watching this session for the first time, today is their first, if they are watching it first class today. So, may I tell you that I have already, good morning, Trinath, Anand Kumar, Jai Surya. So, this particular chart, students, which is there, I have already have pushed this chart in my Telegram channel, or this number which you can see right now immediately if you want. These are the contact numbers. Please ensure to message them and they will give you the PDF file. Harish, Padma, Rahul, good morning to all of you. So just ensure that all of you have this particular material. This is a colorful, comprehensive 28 slides, and this covers all your syllables in a most decisive and comprehensive manner. So you can say your last minute revision or your last final days revision, this is a chart that will definitely go a long way. I have created the index, students. Again, quickly, those index would always be borne in mind, because when you have to revise it, you may actually choose and pick. Whatever you want to choose and pick, you can definitely choose and pick, and accordingly you can revise the same. Harish, Siva, good morning. Now students, I've also told to some of you while yesterday we were discussing that if possible this 28th slide, although there is total 30th slide, but as you can see in between there are information slide which is there, total there are 28 slides. You can take a printout, do a spiral binding and keep this copy ready, because this, as I told you, you will keep on using it again and again. Half an hour you have time, you want to do a quick revision of income tax. How you are going to do it? Do a quick revision through this particular chart. This would be the best way, students. You can revise your entire syllables in a very short span of time, and that is the reason why this chart, may keep it handy with all of you. That is what my request is. Rahul, can we get this notes for paying, sir? You were going to put on side if possible. Paying, we could have printed it, but as I told you, like for us, the logistic sending these notes to different locations of India would have taken time. But we will definitely will see in this regard. Somebody who wants to buy this, we can definitely will try to make this arrangement, and I will definitely will try to take you through to the respective our dealers who will be selling this particular slides for all of you. Let's start, students, then the day session. Yesterday, the first session that we have discussed, students, the basic concept. I was talking that this, what we discussed yesterday, was mainly the MCQ. And this slide of slide number one that we discussed, the tax rate also, specifically the marginal relief calculation, students, this is majorly your MCQ. The MCQ is what probably you can expect in the examination. We have done one particular practical problem, and one practical problem I have given to you as an assignment. Hopefully all of you would have gone through the same. Students, one more particular point which I just wanted to suggest here to all of you. Tomorrow when I will do house property, I will be doing some module questions as well. So we will discuss certain module question as well in the tomorrow's class. So tomorrow we will require a module, whereby I will keep the module, you will also keep the module, and we will try to solve some questions from module. I will pick and choose which are the critical questions that we can solve from the same. Today, let's start with this one. Today, I had given you also an assignment to quickly revise the residential status. Hopefully, you would have done it. Why this residential status is important for us? Because, so this why the question which we have asked here, why this particular residential status is important for us? Because students, the scope of the total income which is chargeable under the act depends upon the residential status of the person. Whereas a person, if he is a resident, then the world income is taxable, and if he is a non-resident, then only the Indian income is taxable. And I have defined the Indian income for all of you, and that Indian income was the income which is accrued or deemed to have accrued in India, or the income which is received in India. So this is what constitute your Indian income. In yesterday's example, students, while I was discussing with all of you, I have told you that the remittances, if it has been made from outside India, remittances which was being made from outside India, that remittance will not be considered as a first time receipt. I told you yesterday, I gave you the example of your friend who has went abroad for the purpose of employment, stayed there, and then what happened, the whatever is the investment income, he is receiving that income in his bank account in Singapore, and from that bank account in Singapore he is remitting this particular amount in India. So that remittance is not a receipt in India, make no mistake. That remittance is not a receipt in India, it is received where? Outside India. So therefore, this remittance which you are focusing upon is the something which once received outside India subsequently has been given to subsequently has been passed on to India. That is not a receipt, that will still be a foreign income. That will still be a foreign income. So students, the residential status is important for the purpose of determining the scope. The only trickiest part was about resident and not ordinary resident. Yesterday's discussion, resident and not ordinary resident. Students, whereas if you are a resident, generally your world income is taxable. What is world income? Indian income as well as foreign income. World income is taxable. But if you are an R and NOR, then one portion of foreign income will not be charged to tax. And that is an income, the foreign income, that is which is accrued as well as received outside India, which is that income which is accrued and received outside India is not in relation to a business or a profession which is set up or a control from India. This is not, that income should not be in relation to a business or a profession which is set up or controlled from India. In that particular case, this foreign income which is accrued and received outside India will not be charged to income tax. This foreign income which is both accrued and received outside India will not be charged to income tax. Isn't it? Good morning, Sri Shushant. Good morning to all of you. Sri, good morning. So students, just keep this particular point in mind. And now with that, quickly, very quickly, we will do this residential status. Again, students, what I sincerely feel, even this residential status as well, you will get it in the MCQ. Because see, inter-CA IPCC taxation, if you see, it is both income tax as well as GST. And because of the division, which are the area of your syllables that they will try to focus on the MCQ, I'm just trying to tell you on that. I'm just trying to guide you on that. So my thought is that even the residential status, they will try to target in the MCQ side. Let's see primarily what they will do. That is something that ICI will have to look out for. But just focus on this particular part. Let's talk about the residential status. We'll start with the first one being for an individual. Now for an individual, students, I told you yesterday, or for an individual as well as for an HUF, you have resident and ordinary resident. You have resident and ordinary resident, that is what the distinction is. So once you are a resident, if you are an individual or HUF, once you have become a resident, you have to further see whether you are or whether you can be considered to be a resident, an ordinary resident, or resident but not ordinary resident. Now, how do we decide that the person is a resident, an ordinary resident? How do we decide that? For that very purpose, students, we will look into it. Let's have a look. First of all, the residential status: 182 days stay and 60 days and 365 days. So there are two basic conditions. This is the basic condition, and out of the two basic condition, you have to satisfy any one of the two basic condition. And what is that? First basic condition: the current year stay should be minimum 182 days. That is the first basic condition. And the second basic condition, students, is primarily 60 days in the current previous year and in the last four preceding previous year. In the last 4 years, you should have minimum of 365 days stay in India. You should have what? Minimum of 365 days stay in India. One point, students, you should be very careful about it is this. See, for the basic condition, they are only talking about the stay in India. You are an individual. You may be a citizen. You may be a foreign national. Doesn't matter. The focus is on the stay in India. So, whoever you may be, person of Indian origin, foreign national, Indian national, your stay will be the decisive factor. So, if you have crossed or if you have touched the threshold of 182 days, if the first basic condition, or you have touched the threshold of 60 days in the current year and 365 days in the last 4 years, then in that particular case, your stay in those particular cases will make you a resident in India. Your stay in those cases will make you a resident in India. Students, can you see the star mark which I have made it here? There is a star mark which is done over here. So, here in students, this star mark, please read this one quickly. Exceptions: replace 60 days with 182 days. Quickly, students, read this particular part. Replace 60 days with 182 days. Fine, students. Now, please pay attention, students. You can easily make a mistake in the MCQ question. As far as the 60 days test and the last 4 years, so there are two basic tests. One of the two basic tests you have to satisfy if you have to become a resident. One of the two basic tests you have to satisfy if you have to become a resident. So, the second basic test is 60 days stay in India. 60 days, minimum 60 days stay in India in the current year. And in the last 4 years, minimum 365 days stays in India. In last 4 years, minimum 365 days stay in India. Now, what I am trying to only repeat on this point is that, students, for that 60 days and 365 days, you don't have to see whether you are an Indian citizen or you are a foreign national. You don't have to see that. I'm repeating it again. You don't have to see that. But the moment you want to replace that 60 days and the 365 days with 182 days criteria, meaning thereby that 60 days and 365 days will not be considered, and only 182 days will be looked upon. Only one basic test. So we can write here, students, only one basic test. Only one basic test to determine. Only one basic test to determine whether the individual, is a resident or not. Only one basic test. So to whom this privilege is given that for you only one basic test would be considered? Both the basic test will not be looked upon. Only one basic test. The privilege is given to an Indian citizen. To whom, students? I'll just put a block like this. This privilege is given to whom? To an Indian citizen. Privilege has been given to an Indian citizen. okay, leaving India in the previous year, leaving India as a previous year primary as a member of a, so either as a member of a crew of an Indian ship or for the purpose of employment in India. So there are three boxes. You have to be an Indian citizen. You are leaving India primarily. You are leaving India in the current year either as a member of a crew of an Indian ship. If you are a crew member of an Indian ship, so you are leaving India either as a member of the crew of the Indian ship, or you are leaving India for the purpose of employment outside India, or you are leaving India for the purpose of the employment outside India. One of the two, either being because you are a member of the crew of the Indian ship, you are living in India, or you have taken up the employment outside India. One of the two should have satisfied. So just, I was taking your example, children. Just think about your example. Once you qualify as a chartered accountant, maybe you are looking for a job opportunity abroad. So what will happen? You will then, are you an Indian citizen? Yes, you are an Indian citizen. Now, in this case, now how do we establish that you are an Indian citizen? Through your passport. Primarily through your passport, it can be established that you are an Indian citizen. Now, secondly is what? The fact that you are leaving India. Yes, you are leaving in India in the previous year. For what purpose? For the purpose of taking up the employment outside India. Then in that year, students, so you are leaving, say for example, in the month of, in the month of July. In the month of July, you are leaving India. Say, example, July 2020, you have left India. For what purpose you have left India? For the purpose of taking up the employment outside India. So please be careful. Even if what? In the previous year, 2021, because you have left in July 20. So in the previous year, 2021, although your stay is for minimum 60 days or more than 60 days. But are we supposed to look that 60 days condition in this situation when you, being an Indian citizen, you are leaving India for the purpose of taking up the employment outside India? Will we look upon that 60 days and the 365 days condition? And the answer is no. For you, then we will only consider the 182 days condition. And did you exceed that condition of 182 days? To that, the answer is no. You haven't crossed the threshold of 182 days. And since you have not crossed the threshold of 182 days, because you are leaving in July 2020. So since in the previous year, 2021, since in the previous year, 2021, you have not crossed the threshold of 182 days. Therefore, you will be considered as a non-resident. Congratulations, students. You have become a non-resident. Now you have taken up the employment outside India. Now one blunder you will do. What is that blunder that you are going to do? Once you take the employment outside India, you will tell your employer, look, my parents are there in India. I have to take care of my parents also. So what you do is that out of $5,000, that is a salary that you give it to me, $1,000 you directly credit. You means the employer, your foreign employer, you are telling to him, you please directly credit $1,000 to my bank account situated in India. $1,000, please directly credit to my bank account situated in India. What does it imply? Can you tell me, students, what does it imply? Out of 5,000, 1,000, you have told to your foreign employer to credit it to your bank account in India. What does it imply? Type it very quickly. Ferry. Priyanka, Nishank, Pratnap, Sushant, is it a remittance? Is it a remittance? Answer is no, students. This is not a remittance. This is not a remittance. Remittance is when you have received it first. You have received it first in the foreign country, and then you are pushing that money in India. That is remittance. First you have to receive and then you push. That is remittance. But here, what you told to your foreign employer, please directly send this money or credit this money to my bank account, which is to my parents' bank account, which is situated in India. So I'm not receiving $1,000. I have received in the foreign country only $4,000. $1,000 I'm telling to my foreign employer, kindly credit to this bank account which I have giving it to him, which is my parent bank account in India. So this $1,000 is received for the first time in India, and hence this $1,000 will be taxable in India. Be careful again. Please don't make this mistake, students. This is where you are making the mistake. Remittance, again, I'm telling you, means what first you receive in the foreign country. First you receive in the foreign country, then you transfer that amount in India. Once you have received it, then you transfer it. That is remittance. But directly crediting the amount in India, Indian bank account, that is not a remittance. That is a first time receipt. So be very careful, students. You should not make a mistake in this case. Yes, Thomas. So here, I think you can easily now appreciate that you are going to make a blunder if you ask your foreign employer to directly credit the amount in my parent bank account. Then you are clearly making a blunder. What you should tell to your employer? What you should tell to your foreign employer? You should tell, give me my entire salary. Where? In the foreign country. Why? Because you have already become a non-resident. So give me the entire salary in the foreign country. And once I got the entire salary in the foreign country, then what you should do? Then you should push some portion of money to your parents, because that will be considered as what? As a remittance. Because that will be considered as a remittance. Now I hope that this point is clear to all of you. Fine. So 182 days, only one basic condition would be applicable in the following case which we are discussing right now. The second basic condition will not be looked upon. Now just continue the story, students, a bit further, and then we'll close this discussion. Now obviously you will keep on coming in India to visit your parents, and everyone knows there is 1 month paid leave kind of a thing which you will always get. So you'll keep coming in India in a year one time to keep visiting to your parents in India. So 1 month you are dropping in India, visiting with your parents. That time, students, be careful. Now what they have said, see how smart they are. Here, students, how smart they are, students. Now they are writing Indian citizen or a person of Indian origin. Can you see? These are the very critical word. Why person of Indian origin? Why here now they are giving for person of Indian origin? Because it may so happen that you already would have taken up the citizenship of that foreign country. And therefore, because you have taken the citizenship of that foreign country, you have already renounced your citizenship of India. Now you are holding the passport of that foreign country, primarily. So you now may have renounced your citizenship in India, isn't it? Now you are a citizen of that foreign country. All the relationship primarily is over, isn't it? But your root is still of your Indian origin. But you cannot snap out your roots. Your roots are still of this land. You are a person of Indian origin. How do you define that you are a person of an Indian origin? Either you, students, or your parents, or your grandparents. Grandparents from your mom's side or your father's side. Doesn't matter. So either you or your parents or your grandparents are born in India, then in that particular case, you will then be considered to be a person of Indian origin. So in that situation, if tomorrow when you go abroad and you have taken the citizenship of that foreign country, can you still be considered as a person of an Indian origin? And the answer is yes. So now you are coming. India calling always would be there, because the origin is from India. So you'll keep visiting India time to time. Primarily, and then now why you are now coming in India for visit purpose. Can you see the students here? This is a very important word. You are coming in India. So this is how the MCQ question will be asked, students. You have to be very careful. You are coming in India for what purpose? Visit purpose. Now what you are doing outside India? What you are doing in that foreign country? You are in the employment, or you may have started your business also. You have progressed, isn't it? And you are now coming in India for visit purpose. So for you, again, those who are Indian citizen or a person of Indian origin who are coming in India for visit purpose, for them also only one basic test would be applied, which is of 182 days. Okay, but one time, one in one of the year, one of the year, you think that now the Indian attachment is very strong, and now you want to permanently settle in India. You say that fair enough, I've done with the foreign, whatever I have to do in the foreign land. Now it is my homeland. At the end of the day, it is home which matters the most. So you are now permanently coming in India and settling it down in India. Then in that year, the year in which you are coming in India, that year when you are coming in India for permanent settlement, in that year will only be one basic condition would be looked upon, or both the basic condition would be looked upon? Whether only one basic condition would be looked upon or both the basic condition would be looked upon, the answer is both the basic condition would be looked upon. Why? Because now you are not coming in India for visit purpose, you are coming in India for the purpose of a permanent settlement. So students, both the basic condition at that point of time would be looked upon. So here itself, be careful students, here itself visit in India, that is fine, but permanent settlement in India, both the condition. Permanent settlement in India, both the basic condition. I hope that all of you have got hold with this particular point. Fine students, so this is very important students. You can write this box to be very important for MCQ purpose. Very important for MCQ purpose. Students, I strongly feel that this side they can target to you in the examination. So my humble request is that keep revising this what I have taught you right now. Rest of it, the first box students, the stay in India, you can read it. These are the general information which I have given it to you. You can read it. Now quickly students, I'll just let you know about this particular part, because even this is important for MCQ purpose, this part. So again, this is important for MCQ purpose. So let me quickly run through this particular part as well for all of you. So students, this is about what? The Indian citizen and a member of a crew of a foreign bound ship leaving India. So students, generally when we say stay in India, when we say stay in India, India will include even the territorial waters of India. India will include also the TWI, that is the territorial waters of India. Now that TWI students is the is 12 nautical miles. Now supposingly a particular ship, it is foreign bound, it is a foreign bound ship, it is starting from Vizag, Vishakhapatnam, and it has to go to Dubai. Now that ship, now I am the crew member, I have boarded that ship, I am a crew member, I have boarded the ship. The ship is a foreign bound, which starting from Vishakhapatnam will go to Dubai, and then it will come back to Vishakhapatnam. Okay, and I as a crew member, I am boarded that particular ship. Now what will happen students would be that the problem and the challenge would be this, that in this case you will find that once I board the ship, I will say that okay, I'm leaving the India, I have left India. That is what you will feel. See, when you will take off in an aeroplane also, like from a flight from Mumbai to Singapore, the moment the flight starts, then I will feel that I am outside India, but you are still in the Indian airspace for the next 3 hours. You are still in Indian airspace for the next 3 hours, but who cares? The moment the takeoff happens, we think that we are outside India. Now we are in the foreign country, but in the 3 hours at that time also, you are still in the Indian airspace. So how can you say that you have landed up, you are in the foreign jurisdiction? No. Same way, when I have boarded the ship, at that time, being a crew member, I will feel that I am outside India. Now, see the irony. Please see the irony here, students. The ship from Vishakhapatnam goes first to the Chennai port. Okay, from there also they picks up, they will take some loading of the goods of consignment to be transported finally to Dubai. So the first stop after from Vishakhapatnam is Chennai port. From Chennai it goes to Kochi. From Chennai it is going to Kochi port. There also they are taking some consignment, loading some consignment. From Kochi it is moving to Mumbai. All the coastal area I'm touching, and then Mumbai. From Mumbai it is going to Kandla, Gujarat. There also they are taking some consignment, and then from Gujarat it is finally heading towards Dubai, the port of Jabal Ali. That is the Dubai port, the port of Jabal Ali port. Now they are heading to Dubai. Now you tell me, in this entire scenario, I felt the moment I boarded the ship from Vishakhapatnam, I thought that I am now outside India. But for next 20 days, I was still in India, Why? Because the ship was very much in the territorial water of India. Now, how do I know that I'm still in India? That's so difficult for me to keep on looking into the waters. Am I into TWI? Is there a boundary? All these are very difficult for me to keep checking whether I'm crossing or not. All these things are difficult. So therefore, they have made the law in a simple manner. And what is the simplicity? They have said that, look, Mr. the crew member who are a crew member of a foreign bound ship, for you this period will not be counted as your for the number of days of the stay in India calculation. This period will not be counted for the number of days of the stay in India calculation. Which period? The day when I am joining the ship, that is from Vishakhapatnam, and the day when I am signing it off. Do you know when I am going to sign off? When I am going to sign off? When the ship is going to come back from Dubai, and once I hit to Vishakhapatnam again, that time I will sign off the logbook. So that day when I have boarded the ship and the date when I am signing off the logbook, when I am coming back and I'm signing it off the logbook, those total number of days will not be considered as a stay in India. Those number of days, which is from the date of joining till the date of signing off, will not be considered as, will not be considered as what? Will not be considered as the stay in India. And accordingly, because it will not be considered as a stay in India, it will not be counted for the purpose of the basic test. Students, can you see this example? This is question number one. So here lies the question number one, which is there next to that. I will request to all of you to keep go through this one to after today's lecture. Go through this one. It's a simple one, so it does not require my intervention. This question is given, but please do that, because I strongly feel this is an important MCQ based question. This is an important MCQ based question. So ensure to go through the same. Now students, coming to the second one, and that second one is about the additional condition. Can you see the additional condition? The additional condition part. So students, when I talk about the additional condition here, both the additional condition should be satisfied if you are, once you become a resident, means you have satisfied the basic test, one of the basic test, then you have to further see if you are an individual and HUF, that whether the both the additional condition is satisfied. Now what is that both the additional condition? That he should be resident in India for minimum 2 out of the last 10 previous year. He should be resident in India for minimum 2 out of the last 10 previous year. And the next one is the resident in India, or I'll say students, stay in India. The better word would be stay in India. Stay in India for minimum 730 days in the last 7 previous year. Stay in India should be minimum 730 days in the last 7 previous year. If I satisfy both these additional condition, then my status will become RNOR. And if I don't satisfy any of the additional condition, or I satisfy only one additional condition, then my status would be RNNOR. What is the distinction? What difference it will make being an RNOR versus RNNOR? The difference I have already yesterday have given it to you in our discussion, so I'm not touching upon it right now. Coming to this particular part, students, here for an HUF, students, just focus this particular part now. For an HUF firm and AOP, for an HUF firm and AOP, they would be a resident, they would be considered to be a resident if the control and management of the affairs, if the control and management of the affairs is wholly or partly in India. If the control and management of the affair is wholly or partly in India. So if as an HUF or as a firm or as an AOP, if the control and management of that firm or of that HUF or of that AOP is even if partly situated in India, even if partly situated in India, that HUF or the firm or the AOP will be considered as what? Will be considered as a resident. Now, students, be careful. If you are an HUF, and there's a part control, if you are an HUF and the part control is in India, then I told you what? You have become a resident. Now for the HUF students, for the HUF, you have to see further. You have to see further what? whether the additional condition has been satisfied or not. Now this additional condition, students, which is there, this additional condition which is there has to be decided from whose perspective? From the perspective of the karta. So karta should be a resident in India. Karta should be resident in India. So he should be a resident in India. The karta should be resident in India for a minimum 2 out of the 10 previous years. Karta should be resident in India for a minimum 2 out of the last 10 previous year. And what about the second one? The karta stay in India should be for minimum 730 days in the last 7 previous year. Okay, if you satisfy both the condition, in this case, if you satisfy both the condition, then the HUF will become RNOR. If you satisfy none of the additional condition or one of the additional condition, then you will be considered as R and NOR. So again, I'm repeating, students, the concept of resident and ordinary resident, or resident but not ordinary resident, is applicable only in respect of individual and HUF. Only in respect of individual and HUF. Just keep this point in mind. With that, now we come to last particular case of, students, the company. The company, students, even this particular part is equally very important. This particular part. This part, Pramnath, this resident I have already have created, and stay for the second one. 730 days is for stay, and resident is for that 2 years, minimum 2 years in the last 10 previous year. That is the condition for residentship. That is the condition for residentship. Students, for as far as the company is concerned, it is there in your module. But please, you have to restrict this discussion limitedly, because in CA final, students, you learn this thing in a very deep. This particular concept is very important. But in final CA, we will do a research on this particular concept. Not right now. We are just touching upon whatever is applicable for your inter CA examination. We are just touching upon only to secure the interest for your MCQ part of it. Now, if you are a company, if as a person you are a company, then how do we decide that you are a resident or you are a non-resident? See, one thing which I am again repeating this point, if you are a firm, if you are an AOP, if you are a cooperative society, or if you are a company, then you will be either be considered as a resident or you will be considered as a non-resident. There is no further subdivision. If you have become a resident, then there is no further subdivision of resident and ordinary resident, or resident but not ordinary resident. So this subdivision does not exist. So just keep that point in mind. Therefore, with that particular proposition, students, with that particular proposition, coming back over here in this situation, if you are a company, then how do we decide that you are a resident or not? Then in that case, students, then in that particular case, the company, if you are an Indian company, then by default you will be considered as a resident. However, if you are not an Indian company, that is to say, if you are a foreign company, students, be careful on this. If you are a foreign company, then in this situation you will be considered as a resident in India. If the place of effective management of that foreign company, if the place of effective management, which we say also as POEM, is it in India? This is what you need to check out. Is the POEM in India? If you say yes, the POEM is in India of that foreign company, if the POEM, place of effective management, it is getting effectively managed from India, even though it is a company which is incorporated outside India, it will still be considered to be a resident. If it is effectively managed from India, it will still be considered as a resident. But if you say no, the POEM of this foreign company is not situated in India, then what is the scenario? It will be considered as what? As a non-resident. Some students will say, sir, what do you mean by place of effective management? So students, this is what is a place of effective management. Place where the key management and the commercial decision, the key means the important management and the commercial decision which are necessary to be conducted for the business are made. So they are the key management and commercial decision. Where they are made, in substance, where they are made. Is it made it in India? If the answer is yes, then that foreign company will be considered as a resident in India. I am actually getting very tempted to give you a lot of examples and all, but I can also know that they are irrelevant at your level. So at least once refer this flow chart and that will work for you for the purpose of your examination. Okay, so just this much of the flow chart will be sufficient enough for your purpose of examination. There are a lot of other research that we will do while you come into final CA. So students, in the previous chart number 2, again, I hope that all of you are marking what is important. You have already marked. This is important for your MCQ. This is important for your MCQ students. Okay. This is your MCQ based particular question, which I have already now mentioned to all of you. I have given you one typical example here. This is a one typical example. Rest, whatever you have done it, that is fine. But whenever you keep revising this chart, please ensure to revise this typical example. Whenever you keep revising this chart, keep revising this typical example. Rest of it are a normal thing. Basic test. And as I told you, one of the two basic tests should be satisfied. But where you are falling in that exception, going abroad for the purpose of employment, or coming in India for visit, then only one basic test would be applicable. That is what you will see. And thereafter, both the additional test would also be looked upon. The moment you become a resident, both the additional test would also be looked upon to further verify whether you can be considered as a resident, an ordinary resident, or resident but not ordinary resident. Now, please come to this particular part. Students, yesterday I have finished off this, the scope. This scope was important for us to decide why, what is the difference that will make if you are a resident or you are a non-resident, or what is the difference that will make if you are a resident and ordinary resident versus a resident but not ordinary resident. This discussion, students, we have already have concluded. Now students, again, this part, which is, I think many students are leaving this as an option, and that is student section number 9. Many students leave this as an option. Although I do appreciate, or I do agree, again, this is a very much a final CA material. In fact, students, you will have 30 marks allocated for this side. And we do lot of lectures after lectures only on this section 9. But the fact that I've seen some question also in your module, therefore, it is an important one. At least I will teach you. I will teach you whatever is relevant for your intermediate. I will restrict myself only to whatever is relevant, and on that note only I have prepared the chart. Let's start with this one. Students, we were looking for an Indian income, and in the Indian income yesterday we have said that the income, Indian income, would be income which is either you have received in India, income which you have either received in India, and what about the second one? Received in India. And what about the second one? So received or deemed to have received, and second one is accrued or deemed to have accrued in India. Now, as I told you, this is a critical factor for the Indian income, because for a non-resident, only this two incomes, which is either received in India or accrued in India, only this two incomes will be charged to tax in India. For a non-resident, only this two category of income, which is received in India or accrued in India, will be charged to tax under the Act. The foreign income for the non-resident, is not chargeable to tax in India. So what the government have done, students, is that they have sought to clarify as to what constitutes the accrual or the deemed accrual. What constitute the accrual or the deemed accrual? This is what they have sought to clarify through section number 9. This is what they have sought to clarify. Clarify through what? Through this section number 9. So I'm just connecting this part so that you understand that okay, this is what they are try to focus in the section number 9. In the section number 9. In the section number 9. Okay, shall I begin with it? All of you are ready? Because this is a very important discussion, students, that we are now going to have it. So your readiness is very important for me also. Are you ready? Yes, let's start then. Students, let's look upon, I'll give you through examples only, I'll try to make you understand it, because it is important that you understand it, and then you will be in a position to write in your own words. Student, this section, even if you write in your own words, it is still fine, but you should write correct thing, because at IPCC level, inter CA level, they will not expect you moon. In final CA level, you have to even write this sentence in a technically, you have to be very correct, but right now overall conceptual understanding is what is required. And even if you write in your own words, but the direction is correct, you'll get full marks, or they will not deduct much marks. So first one, students, let's continue with this example. You went abroad for the purpose of employment. Let me change that example a bit. You went abroad along with your parents. You have went abroad along with your parents. So students, you have taken with your parents along with you, because there in that foreign country, they have arranged the accommodation also. So in that situation, students, the Indian home that you had, what you did, you have given it on rent. Now, as I told you, you went in July, and your stay in India, in the year in which you have left India for the purpose of employment, your stay in India was for less than 182 days. Therefore, you became non-resident. The house in India was in your name. That house you have given it on rent. Question therefore is that rental income, now you are a non-resident, the rental income you are telling directly credit to my bank account in Singapore. To whom you are telling this? You are telling it to your tenant. Your tenant is a banker. He works in Citibank. So what you told to your tenant, that look, Mr. Tenant, you are working in Citibank, do one thing, my rental income, you directly credit that rental income in a Citibank account in Singapore directly. That tenant is doing the needful. The question therefore to all of you is that rental income will be considered as an income which is accrued where this income is said to have been accrued or deemed to have accrued, students, where that income would have said to have accrued or deemed to have accrued. In this case, it would have been said to have accrued or deemed to have accrued where? In India. You will say what? Repeat with me. You will say the rental income in respect of property which is situated in India, the income in respect of a property which is situated in India, will this be considered to have been accrued or deemed to have accrued in India? And the answer is yes. So repeat with me, income arising from a property situated in India. Income arising from a property situated in India, that income will be said to be accrued or deemed to have accrued in India. That is the first particular thing, students, here. So in this context, if you have a look in this situation, students, in this situation, if you can just have a look. Income accruing or arising outside India, directly or indirectly, through or from point number here, business connection in India is there. Okay, but I am not doing right now business connection. I am doing this part. This is the most easiest part. Any property or asset or income in India. What is the example I gave it to you? Property was situated in India. You have become a non-resident. You have given that property on rent, and you have told your tenant, what, kindly give me this income to my Citibank account in Singapore. we can easily say that this income to you is an income which has accrued in India. Reason being, the reason was the property or the asset was situated in India. So please don't do this hard work that you want to receive this particular income outside India. Still it will be taxable in India. Why it will be taxable in India? Because this income has accrued in India. This income has accrued in India. So even though you are receiving it outside India, the fact that it has accrued in India, it will altogether be taxable in India. So students, this is the reason why this will be an Indian income. So will this be an Indian income? And the answer is yes, it will be an Indian income. Why I say it is an Indian income? Because just now I told you, as far as the Indian income is concerned, one of the two should have been satisfied. And what is it? One of the two, either that income should have been received in India. But in my example, I told that you are telling your tenant that the rent should be directly credited to the Citibank account outside India. So therefore, the income is received outside India. Fine. But the fact that this is arising from a property which is situated in India, this income will be considered to have been accrued in India. If it is an income which is considered to have been accrued in India, will this qualify as an Indian income? And the answer is yes. So either this or this, that should have happened to be considered as an Indian income. Either this or this should have happened for this to be considered as an Indian income. This is what, students, it will be considered as. Did you all got this one? Now, this point, students, is about the business connection. This is a typical thing. So students, we will discuss right now the business connection part. Now, this business connection, students, if you see on the top side and right hand side, we have discussed this term business connection. This term. Very tricky. Now, students, can you see business connection includes and business connection excludes? So all this is, students, again, please, if you can write MCQ. These are all MCQ based question. IC has covered this, so they are all MCQ based question. Now, you will limit as to what I am discussing in this case. Okay? Students, please pay attention in this regard. Business connection is what? Because income is deemed to accrue or arise in India if that non-resident has got a business connection in India. So if any person, non-resident, has a business connection in India, then in that case, this income of the non-resident will be considered as an Indian income. Why it will be considered as an Indian income? Because it is an income which is accrued or deemed to have accrued in India. This is what it will be considered. Pay attention to business connection, the way the definition structure, students, structure, pay attention to the structure. If I see the structure very carefully, I find that the business connection, it includes the following, and the business connection, it excludes the following. Okay, so we'll do one by one. First, business connection, what it includes. So the inclusive definition, students, if we can read it together, any business activity carried out through a person who is acting on behalf of the non-resident. Who is acting on what? On behalf of the non-resident. So in this regard, students, in this regard, any business activity carried out through a person who is acting on behalf of the non-resident, and that person is, students, the agent. Who is that person through whom you are acting primarily? The person is an agent. Now please understand, students, and try to I'll give an example. Through example only you'll learn. Students, supposingly a non-resident, if they have got the branch in India, a branch in India, then that's it. They are doing a business in India. Yes, they are doing a business in India. If you remember, there is this IKEA departmental store. Are you aware of this IKEA departmental store? It is in Hyderabad. IKEA. The departmental store IKEA, it is in Hyderabad. Now I think this company is a Sweden based company, and it has got one branch or one outlet in India. So since it has got one branch or one outlet in India, we can easily say, we can say what? Are you, so okay, some students are not aware of it. IKEA is a Sweden-based company. Now, it has got one particular outlet in Hyderabad. Departmental store, very big departmental store. So when in Hyderabad, please do visit once. So can we say this Sweden company, which is a non-resident, so it is a foreign company? Is it a foreign company? Yes, it is a foreign company. Where its key management decision has been taken, where this foreign company is taking the key management and commercial decision, this foreign company IKEA, based in Sweden, is taking the key management and commercial decision from Sweden. And therefore, it is a non-resident. Yes, it is a non-resident. Why? Because its poem is situated outside India. Its poem, students, is situated outside India. So it is a non-resident in India. Now, this non-resident in India is having one branch. It is having its own physical presence. Own physical presence in India. How it is having a own physical presence in India? By having a branch in India. By having what? A branch in India. Thereby, it is having its own physical presence. So can we say this IKEA Sweden, this IKEA Sweden is having a business connection in India? And the answer is yes. Why it is having a business connection in India? Because I am physically present in India and I'm doing the business in India. I am physically present in India and I am doing the business in India. Therefore, I will say what? Say that I have a business connection with India, and since I have got a business connection in India, the conclusion that we will say the income arising from this business connection, the income arising from this business connection will be deemed to have accrued or rise in India. The income arising from this business connection will be deemed to have accrued or rise in India. As simple as that. Coming to the next particular point, should please pay attention. Supposingly, I don't have my business connection in India. I don't have any physical presence in India. But I have got what? I have got some agents who are exclusively working for me in India. I have got what? I have got my agents who are exclusively working for me in India. You'll say, sir, what kind of exclusively they are working for you in India? So, students, they are working. This is a box. Now, students, this is a very technical. ICA should have avoided this technical boxes and all. I will substitute with a simple box, box number A. So the A, I'll just write here, agent. Just in a simple word, I'm just substituting this one. Non-resident agent, first box in India. Is playing an important role to conclude. To conclude, the non-resident contracts in India. So, what that agent is doing in India, what is the role of that agent in India? So, the role of that agent in India is this, that look, Mr. Agent, you will identify the buyers. You will enter into the agreement. You will enter into the negotiation. Which will help us to conclude the contracts in India, business contracts in India. So, Mr. Ron Agent, you are being appointed for the purpose of concluding or playing the important role for the purpose of concluding the business contract for the non-resident. Now, how do we conclude this contract? The conclusion of the contract would be, students, that the agent will be negotiating with the buyers in India. Terms and conditions, everything, all these things will be set across by the agent, and thereby the business contract of the non-resident will be concluded. So if this is what your agent is performing in India, if this is what your agent, your means non-resident agent is performing it in India, we can easily say what? That this non-resident has got a business connection in India. Through this agent, the non-resident has got a business connection in India. Through this agent, the non-resident has got a business connection in India. This is what can be put across in a simple understanding. Second, point number B. The all students, can you see A, B and C? All this activity of the agent are independent activity. So it's not that A plus B plus C. No. It is A or B or C. A or, so agent is doing. What agent is doing? A or B or C. A or B or C. So if a non-resident has an agent in India who is doing what? A or B or C, then this non-resident will have a business connection in India, and through that business connection, whatever is the income of the non-resident, that income of the non-resident will be deemed to have accrued or rise in India. So this non-resident agent in India should do either A or B or C. This is how you revise. A or B or C, and if that happens, then the non-resident can be said to have a business connection in India, and through that business connection, whatever is the income which arises, we can say and conclude that that income for the non-resident is an income which is deemed to have accrued or arise in India, and therefore it is an Indian income, and because it is an Indian income, it will be charged to tax. Now, what is this point number B, students? Very easy point. If you see point number B is habitually maintains stock of goods and delivers the goods on behalf of non-resident. Now, this point number B is very unique thing. Do you know what is that point number B? Here, the agent is acting like a stockist. Students, stockist. Do you know what is a stockist? The stockist is the one who will only stock the goods. So, here this agent is not identifying the buyers, is not negotiating the terms and condition with the buyers. Here, what they are doing simply is they are stocking the goods. Okay, so non-resident is dispatching the goods to the premises of the agent. The agent is stocking the goods in India. That's it. Agent is stocking the goods in India. Now, what they will do of these goods? As and when the non-resident will give him the instruction, he will keep dispatching the goods as per the instruction received from the non-resident. This is the only activity which the agent perform. This is the only activity which the agent perform in India. So if you means if the non-resident has got such agent in India, what is the activity of the agent in India in this case? Activity is to stock the goods on behalf of the non-resident for the purpose of dispatch as per the instruction of the non-resident. So if the non-resident has got such agent in India, then the income arising from this activity, can it be said to have been deemed to have accrued in India? Again, the answer is yes. The income arising from such activity will be considered as an income which is deemed to have accrued or arise in India. So this is again the same proposition, students, that will happen. So this is one thing you should keep in mind. Point number B. So here the activity is only to stock the goods for the purpose of dispatch as per the non-resident's instruction. In that case also, the non-resident will be said to have a business connection in India, and through this business connection, whatever is the income which arises, that income will be referred as an income which is deemed to have accrued or arise in India. And point number C, students, is the normal point. And what is the normal point? It is habitually securing the order. In fact, students, you all know that this is the main activity. This is the main activity of the agent only. This is the main activity of the agent. What is the activity of the agent? To habitually secure the order in India. This is the main activity. So that is one thing which you should always keep in mind. And with that, now students, we quickly run through the exclusion side. So this is what, if, again I'm repeating, students, pay attention, if the non-resident has got an agent in India who is performing either activity A or activity B or activity C, then in that case the non-resident will be said to have a business connection in India, and through that business connection, whatever is the income which arises, that income will be considered as an income which is deemed to have accrued, income which has deemed to have been accrued or rise in India. And accordingly, this would be an Indian income. And if it is an Indian income for a non-resident, I told you, will it be taxed in India? And the answer is yes, it will be taxed in India. Now, for the exclude part, students, can you quickly run through this exclusion side? For the exclusion side, students, can you just quickly run through this? Quickly, students, and if I may, Ravenclaw, yes, in that case, a foreign company, what you are asking, that foreign company would be considered to be a resident in India. In fact, that is the example which I give it in the final CA classes. The first example is the Jaguar car only. This is a classic example. But what you are asking is indeed is a case of a resident in India. Students, please tick mark this particular part. Operation confined to, students, highlight the word confined. Operation which is confined. Confined means restricted to. Restricted to what? Restricted to purchase for the purpose of export. Purchase for the purpose of export. Now, students, you will say, sir, does the section 9 comes in the examination? I will say to you that please don't take chance in November attempt, for the only reason that enough of the leaves were being given and it is there in your module, comprehensively covered in your module. So do little bit thing and try to understand it conceptually and leave it that way, because it will be striked in the examination, and only those who would have understood it conceptually, they will be in a position to deal with it, at least something they can make a life out of it. So don't leave this part. I'm just mark my words. So what it excludes, operations which are confined to purchase for the purpose of export. Operation which is confined. Confined means, students, restricted. You say, sir, what is the example? Example is like this. Non-resident, what they are doing? They are buying from India all the spices. And then what they do? They are exporting that particular spices back to their country. Now, they don't have any physical presence in India. They don't have any physical presence in India. Primarily, their only activity is purchase the spices from India and they are exporting it. That's it. But if you say, no, sir, they are purchasing the spice from India, plus they are storing, but you are adding one more activity. They are storing also in India, and thereafter they are dispatching or exporting out of India. If you include one more activity, then this will not, the benefit of this exclusion will not be available. What does it imply then? If there is one more activity, then in this case, it will imply that the non-resident will have a business connection in India. Then this will imply that the non-resident will have a business connection in India. So you have to be very careful about this part. So operations which are confined to purchase of the, for the export, for the purpose of export. So I gave you the example. I am purchasing the spices, purchasing and directly exporting. I am doing nothing else. If you do anything further, then in that case, what I have told you, in that case, I have told you that the benefit of the exclusion will not be available. Next point, students, is about the agency. Now, BBC, CNN, if they are picking up the news from India and they are putting this news, like election news, they are taking the election news from India and putting it in their papers. So, can we say that BBC or CNN, who is the non-resident, they have a business connection in India? And the answer is no. Although some sale, because there are many Indians who stays abroad and they are interested to hear the Indian news, and therefore one can argue that some portion of the sale is because of the Indian readers, and for the Indian readers you are picking up the news from India, But the activity of picking up the news from India, is it a business connection in India? Will it give rise to a business connection in India? To that, they have said it, no. And if it is not a business connection in India, then no income of BBC and CNN will be deemed to have accrued or rise in India. Same case, students, many of the films that you see, you find that shooting is done. Like there is one movie that was being made, Gandhi. Now this is a, this was made by a Britisher. That Gandhi movie was made by a Britisher. He was, the producer was a Britisher. Now all the star cast was, only the main character Gandhi, he was Britisher. Rest everyone else was Indian. The location, the shooting location was also from India. Question therefore was whether that non-resident who is shooting in India, the cinema film, he is shooting the cinema film in India, can we say that whatever income that he earns from that film, some portion of income, is it because of a business connection in India? The exclusion says no, it will not be considered as a business connection in India. It will not be considered as a business connection in India. So operation which are confined to, restricted to what? Shooting of the cinema films in India. That's it. The rest of it, don't read it. Only shooting of the cinema films in India. That's it. So this is what you at least will try to remember. Okay. So this much at least it is expected from all of you. So what we have done so far, students, please pay attention here. What we have done so far, two things. Income which is deemed to accrue rise in India, two things. If the income is because of the property or the asset which is situated in India, can we say that the income from such property or such asset situated in India, can we say that the income has deemed to have accrued rise in India? And the answer is yes. We can say that the income is deemed to have accrued or arise in India if it is arising from the property or asset which is situated in India. What about the next point which I have discussed with you? The next point was about business connection. If the non-resident is having a business connection in India, then the income from that business connection is also an income which is deemed to have accrued rise in India. And that will also be considered as an Indian income, chargeable to tax in the hands of the non-resident. That will also be considered as an Indian income, chargeable to tax in the hands of the non-resident. I gave you the example of IKEA having a physical branch in India. Then they have the business connection because they are doing the business themselves in India. But the second example was a classic one, the agent. I'm not doing the business in India, but I have got an agent in India who is doing activity A or activity B or activity C. If that is the case, then this non-resident through that agent in India will have a business connection in India. And whatever is the income which arises from such business connection, we can say that income is accrued or deemed to have accrued or arise in India. That income has accrued or deemed to have accrued or arise in India. That is what we will say on that part. And accordingly will be charged to tax. So this is the two point, students, that we will remember. And further, we have seen that in the business connection, there are some exclusions. What is the exclusion? Spices. Spices example. Purchase of the spices for the purpose of export. Second example was, students, news, CNN, BBC, taking the news, election news from India. Then no business connection. And the producer, Gandhi movie, shooting in India, no business connection. Okay, so these are the only exclusion. Just keep in mind, keep it simple as much as possible so as to understand this. The last part, students, last part, try to understand this one, and this, whatever I will teach you, try to understand that last part. And that will be all done, section 9. I hope two part as gift is also covered for all of you, 9-1-8. Hopefully it should not. No, there is also royalty and FTS. This is a technical. So first of all, students, you can just try to take this example and please copy down this in your notebook. This is your chart number 3. I think we are in chart number 3, isn't it? Chart number 3. and income, and this is for section 9. Income is deemed to accrue or arise in India if it is in respect of a property situated in India, that rent example, or business connection in India, the second example, and the third one. The third one, students, is transfer of a capital asset situated in India. Transfer of a capital asset situated in India. So we have done this, we have done this, now we are going to do this last part on this segment, then we will move further. Copied this one, friends? Let me know quickly. Fairy, I think students, if you are through with this, let me know quickly. Fine. Students have said they have done with this. So please pay attention now, students, this part. And I will give you a case study. Quickly, students, case study. Through an example only, you will understand. Through example only, you will try to understand. Otherwise, if you read the theory, you will go mad. And all of you will qualify for ATU deduction if you read only the theory. So quickly, please take the case study. So case study number one, India, USA. India, USA. So here RIL shares, students, RIL shares, Mr. X, what he has done? He has, point number one, purchased shares of RIL at rupees 100 per share. This is point number one. And point number two is, so he has purchased the share of the RIL, and point number two, sold the shares of RIL to Mr. Y at rupees 175 per share. At rupees 175 per share. So what is the question? The question is, whether the capital gains of rupees 75 per share is an income which is deemed to accrue or rise in India. This is the way question will be asked. Small question, students, in the examination. Whether the capital gain of rupees 75 per share, Mr. X is from USA and he has sold this shares also to Mr. Y of USA. And accordingly, the question to all of you is whether the capital gains of rupees 75 per share, is it an income which is deemed to accrue or rise in India? This is the issue under consideration. What is the answer, students? So the answer in this case, what I just now told you, he has sold the shares of the RIL. He has sold the shares of the RIL, isn't it? All of you agree? Where is the shares of RIL situated? Question therefore is, where is the shares of the RIL situated? Where it is situated? The shares of the RIL, students, is situated where? In India. How do we say that the shares of RIL situated in India? The shares of RIL situated in India because it is registered or the RIL as a company, is it incorporated in India? And the answer is yes. Therefore, the shares of the RIL is situated in India. And if the shares of the RIL is situated in India, can we say therefore Mr. X, who is a non-resident, Mr. X, who is a non-resident, has transferred a capital asset, has transferred a capital asset which is situated in India? And the answer is yes. Has transferred a capital asset which is situated in India. Please quickly write the answer. Shares. Point number one. Quickly write the answer. Shares of a company is said to be situated at a place where the company is incorporated. Where the company is incorporated. Therefore, the shares of the RIL is situated in India. Accordingly, point number three, Mr. X, the non-resident, has transferred a capital asset situated in India, and therefore the capital gains shall be, the capital gains on such transfer shall be deemed to have accrued in India. See, in the simple words, students, I am writing this answer. This is the way you have to also write the answers in the exam. This is the way also, students, you write the answers in the exam. In a simple, simple sentence. Okay, so these are the things that has been covered in your module. Comprehensively, they have covered. Do this much, students. Okay, do this much, whatever I am teaching you, as far as section 9 is concerned, and that much would be sufficient for you to crack your exam questions on this section 9, which is comprehensively covered in the module. I hope that all of you have copied this one now. Now, last point students of this, because this is not the provision. The provision is something else now. This is a simple example. This is just a simple example. Now, Mr. X students, let me now complete this particular entire case study. Mr. X now has become very clever. You will say how he has become a clever person. Make it fast, students. Copy down this thing fast. Mr. X has become, students, very clever. He came to know that if I directly sell the shares of the RIL, then no, I cannot be saved. I will have to pay that tax in India because this will be an Indian income. Why it is an Indian income? Because it is an income which is accrued in India. And as you can write, if it is accrued in India, we all know, students, if it is accrued in India, then it is an Indian income. And if it is an Indian income for the non-resident, is it taxable in India? And the answer is yes. For the non-resident, it will be taxable in India. Nobody can save on this part. This will be taxable in India. So what Mr. X did was, he became quite clever person. What was the cleverness? Let me show you the cleverness of Mr. X. So students, the cleverness of Mr. X was like this. Yes, just hold on. Here you are, students. I'll just draw the case study. You can write this as case study 2. Okay. Now you will restrict whatever I am teaching you, students, over here. Don't stretch it, because beyond that there is a final CA theory which comes into picture. We will restrict only what is covered in inter CA. So RIL shares. Okay, now Mr. X, who is there in USA, he became smart enough to know that if I directly purchase the shares of RIL, and then I sell the shares of the RIL, and thereafter I sell the shares of the RIL, then nobody can save me. That capital gains on the sale will be taxed in India. Nobody can save on that. So Mr. X, what he did, as I told you, he became clever, students. So what this Mr. X did was, he floated a company. The first point, students, was this, that this Mr. X floated a company. Now, which company? Say, this company was based in Singapore. Name of the company is, say, ZPLC. Okay, that is the name of the company. So, share capital, say 1 crore or say 100 crore share capital. 100 crore share capital, then cash in bank. So the first journal entry of this company was what? I have purchased the shares. I have floated the company. So I'll subscribe the shares of the company and I've put the money in the company. Cash. So company balance sheet, the company journal entry would be cash in bank account debit to share capital. Now, to whom they have issued the share capital? It was issued to X and X family. 100 crore. Okay, fine. After this floating was over, then the company invested. Then what happened in this case? The Singapore company invested in the shares of the RIL. Students. Okay. Now, after that, what happened? Here, students, the growth rate of RIL was, say, 40%. Every year, it was growing by 40%. Complete up till now. Then I'll do the final explanation. कॉमर्स कंजर्वेटरी, ऑल ऑफ यू विल कंप्लीट दिस पार्ट जस्ट क्विकली. सर यू से इफ कंपनीज इनकॉर्पोरेटेड इन इंडिया देन दे आर इन इंडिया, बट इफ द सेम आर लिस्टेड इन अमेरिकन स्टॉक एक्सचेंज, शेयर्स आर नॉट लिस्टेड. कॉमर्स कंजर्वेटरी शेयर्स आर नॉट लिस्टेड. वॉट इज लिस्टेड इज द ADR एंड GDR. इंडियन कंपनी रिलायंस शेयर्स यू विल नॉट फाइंड इट इन अमेरिकन स्टॉक एक्सचेंज, यू विल नेवर फाइंड इन अमेरिकन स्टॉक एक्सचेंज. वॉट यू विल फाइंड वुड बी ADR एंड GDR, अमेरिकन डिपॉजिटरी रिसीट एंड ग्लोबल डिपॉजिटरी रिसीट, दैट यू लर्न इन फाइनल CA. ओके, सो आई एम नॉट टचिंग अपॉन ऑन दैट कंसेप्ट. All of you copied on this? Fair enough. Now, students, please pay attention to this. Now, what happens? Students, be careful. Now, all the Singapore company money of 100 crores, they've invested in RIL. Singapore company does not do anything. The best part, students, the best part is that Singapore company doesn't do anything. Whatever money it had got, it invested the money in the shares of the RIL. So you will care, you now come to know one thing, students. You will now come to know one thing. That what Mr. X did is that, please mark my sentence. Every one of you will listen to this carefully. What Mr. X has done now is he has invested in the shares of the RIL. He has invested in the shares of the RIL through the Singapore company. Mr. X has invested in the shares of the RIL through the Singapore company. Do you all agree to this? So, Singapore company was made as a medium. Medium for what? Medium for investing in the shares of the RIL. Like it, in a simple, in a very loose word, Singapore company was made like an agent. Singapore company was made like an agent to invest family in the shares of the RIL. Now, students, please understand. Now the real story unfolds. The growth rate of RIL company, we know the Mukesh Ambani case, the growth rate is very high now. So the growth rate is at 40%. With that growth rate, what happens? The share price of RIL will go up. If the share price goes up, what happens? The investment. Who is holding the investment of RIL? Singapore company. So the fair market value of the investment of the Singapore company will also go up. Do you agree to this? The fair market value of the investment of the Singapore company will also go up. Do you all agree to this? Yes. Because whatever be my cost, but my fair market value will go up. And because of the fair market value of your asset going up, students, if the fair market value of the asset goes up, if the fair market value of the asset goes up, what is the impact? I want your answer. What is the impact? If the fair market value of my asset, if it goes up, what is the impact? You will write the answer. Quickly, let me see how many of you can give me the answer on this part. Quickly. If the share, if the fair market value of this particular company's shares goes up, apart from goodwill, students, apart from goodwill, if the fair market value of the shares of the of my investment will go up, the fair market value of the investment goes up. Here, if the FMV value of my investment is going up, what will be the impact? Rahul has got the answer. What will happen? My share price may be at rupees 10 per share. My share price may be at rupees 10 per share. But what will happen? The market price of my shares, whose shares? ZPLC shares, will also increase. The market price of ZPLC shares will also increase. Do you agree to this? Yes. Why it will increase? Because my asset valuation has gone up. So my share price will also go up in the market, even though my face value is 10, but my market value would be very high because my asset value my market value of my investment has gone up. This will influence my own share price in the market. This will influence my own share price in the market. So students, point number one, when Mr. X has floated the company by subscribing the shares at rupees 10 each, at rupees 10 each, you can just add students at rupees 10 each. Now what Mr. X is doing? Last point. Point number four. Mr. Y. So what is point number four? Sold the shares of Dash. Filling the blanks. You will do the filling the blanks. Sold the shares of Dash to Mr. Y at rupees 50 per share. At rupees 50 per share. Filling the blanks. Whose shares now Mr. X is going to sell? Whose shares now Mr. X is going to sell? Indeed, students, all of you got it right. Now he is not selling the shares of RIL. He is selling the shares of ZPLC. He is selling the shares of ZPLC. Perfect, students. So if he is selling the shares of ZPLC, now what they will say, students, in this case, the question is now to be asked is this. Whether the capital gains, how much is the capital gains? 50 minus 10 on transfer of the shares of ZPLC will be taxable in India. This is the question. All of you read this question quickly. And now we will write the provision. What is the provision? But before that, please write this question. Through with this, all of you. We will see if taxable or not taxable, we'll see that. But first of all, ensure that all of you have copied down. And students, please let your friends also know this important revision that has been conducted in this channel. Because this is such an important particular session which we are doing it. And I told you, 28th chart of income tax will be very, very comprehensively be revised. In fact, the income tax session which I am doing it with all of you would be very comprehensively done. In fact, a morning session, Om Trivedi sir, ITSM also, he is doing it very comprehensively. Further, also the timetables, primarily you will be having the timetables of our other revisionary sessions which are due from this month till September end. All the 8 paper revisionary schedules are out. I will say that because I've started early so as to do a very comprehensive revision on this income tax, because somehow the other students don't like much of income tax. This is the general trend which I've seen. And the problem is that because it's 50-50 marks with income tax and GST. And this is also the dangerous particular subject then. But in final CA, students, I'm telling you, if this is weak, final CA would be a huge trouble because this is very vast in nature. So in IPCC, you have to score good marks. One of the ways to score good marks is to be conceptually clear about the subject. So our objective is to just remain conceptually clear so far as the subject is concerned. And on that basis, let's move forward, students. So whether the capital gains on this particular part. Yes. So here, students, now just understand one thing. Here, what will happen? Please pay attention. Here, Mr. X, now he will say what? That look, I have not sold the shares of an Indian company. I have sold the shares of a foreign company. Now, just in the previous case study, we have discussed what? The shares is set to be situated in that country, the shares of a company is set to be situated in that country where the company is incorporated. So now he can easily say that since I have sold the shares of a foreign company, therefore the shares is set to be situated in Singapore. And if there is a capital gains which is accrued, Mr. X is arguing what? If there is a capital gains which is accrued, then that capital gains is accrued where? In Singapore. If there is a capital gains which is accrued, then that capital gains is accrued where? In Singapore. And therefore nothing is taxed in India. This is what Mr. X is now giving an argument. So whether this argument is okay, if the argument is okay, students, then this creates a very big loophole in the law. What is the loophole in the law? Students, the loophole in the law is that this everyone will then invest in India. Everyone will then invest in India, not directly, but indirectly. This is a loophole then. That instead of directly investing in the shares in India, then I will come via foreign company and then I will sell the shares, not of the Indian company, but I'll sell the shares of the foreign company and I'll get my valuation. So this is a very big loophole, and the lawmakers accordingly have recognized this loophole, and on that basis they drafted a law. They made the law. And what is the law? Let me give you in a very simple sentence. If the shares of the foreign company in the bracket ZPLC derives its value from derive its value substantially from the Indian asset, then the shares of such foreign company is deemed to be situated in India. This is the provision. Very important provision. Point number two. In the present case, the shares of ZPLC foreign company derives its value substantially from the investment made in the shares of RIL Indian asset, and therefore the shares of ZPLC is deemed to be situated in India. Is deemed to be situated in India. And the last point, conclusion. Therefore, in the present case, the shares in the present case, these shares of the RIL, sorry, the shares of the ZPLC is deemed to be situated in India. And consequently, the transfer of the shares of ZPLC by Mr. X will result into a capital gains, which is deemed to accrue in India, which is deemed to accrue in India. In the bracket, I am writing Indian income. In the bracket, I am writing Indian income. Therefore, in the present case, the shares of ZPLC is deemed to accrue in India. So, D is deemed to be situated in India, and consequently, the transfer of the shares of ZPLC by Mr. X will result into a capital gains, which is deemed to accrue in India, which will make this as Indian income. Which will make this as what, students? Indian income. Yes, Pramnath, this is the Mauritius route. I hope that all of you have got hold with this point. Only this much you will learn primarily, so that in the next session, students, I will be taking the next, the last limb, 9, 1, 5, 6, and 7. This is the last limb, students. Royalty, interest, royalty, and FTS. This is for interest, income of non-resident, royalty, and FTS. This I'll do it tomorrow. Again, this is the last limb. This is over, students. Our headache is done. So this is where we have to just trade cautiously. So today, students, residential status, the test we have learned. I have given you a lot of examples so as to comprehend the test. That is one, I have given it to you. Secondly, for the company, for the HUF, a typical case, we have seen how they can be considered to be a resident or a non-resident. Thereafter, the Indian income, which represents income which is accrued in India, how the income which is accrued in India will be considered, I have told you through section 9. So far, we have seen in section 9 the three examples. Which are the three examples that we have seen? A property which is situated in India. Your example, you had a house property, went outside India, and gave it on rent. Second was business connection IKEA, and the agent who is doing activity A or activity B or activity C, and then there is an exclusion which will not constitute a business connection. That is it. And the third one is about what? The case which we have discussed right now, a capital gains income arising on the transfer of the capital assets situated in India. One is the case, a direct case. The first one is a direct case, wherein I have directly sold the shares of the RIL. Second is the indirect case, where through the Singapore company, a foreign company, I am holding the shares in RIL, but what I am selling is not the shares of RIL, but the shares of Singapore company. So what is the provision? Provision says that The shares of the Singapore company, which is a foreign company, would be situated in India if its own value is derived substantially from the Indian asset. Which is the Indian asset? RIL. We have seen that in the present case, the RIL has made substantial investment in India. That is the RIL shares. The foreign company ZPLC has made a substantial investment in the shares of the RIL, and therefore we will conclude that its own value, whose value? ZPLC's own value is derived substantially from whom? From the shares of the foreign company, from the shares of the Indian company, which is the Indian asset. And to conclude, the shares of ZPLC would be deemed to be situated in India. And accordingly, if the shares of ZPLC, it is situated in India, then the capital gain on the transfer of the shares of ZPLC, the capital gain on transfer of the shares of ZPLC will be deemed to have accrued a rise. Where it will be deemed to have accrued a rise? It will be deemed to have accrued a rise in India. This, students, is where we are. So, students, what you will do in this regard, students? Additional question, what we should refer? Module you will refer. Additional question would be referred, you will refer module for this one. If any additional question you have to refer, don't do any R&D, technically speaking. Only do whatever primary, you can do it from module, and that is how you will be getting it. Now, students, as a homework today, what you will do, section 10 you will read and come. Section 10 chart, which is the chart number? Thank you. Section 10, students. One homework is now homework, students. Today's homework in chart number 4. Tomorrow. Please read this and come. Chart number 5. Tomorrow, students, will do this. Day after tomorrow, I'm going to start. Tomorrow, we'll go do this, and next class, we'll do the house property, because tomorrow we have to complete till chart number 5. Tomorrow we have to complete till chart number 5. Okay, so 28 charts we have to handle. So tomorrow we'll complete till chart number 5. Your homework, students, is do chart number 5 and come for tomorrow. First is revision. Whatever I have taught you today, you'll revise it. Don't forget to do that question number 1. Can you see this question number 1? In this chart number 2, question number 1. You'll do this question number 1 today. Revise whatever I have taught you primarily. Okay, you can skip now all these things, that box and all, this box and all. You can skip primarily this one now. I've already have given you in the notes. Case study has been given to you. Just do that much. Skip this one also. I'm just deleting this part, students. Unnecessary, don't complicate the things. Delete this one also. It is there in the module, I agree. But just do whatever I have taught you. Only that way is going to come. All these are, we will do a research in final CA on each and everything. Primarily, but right now it is covered in your IPCC module, so do whatever I am telling you to do. Okay, the objective is to just be conceptually be clear. And chart number 5, students, you'll read and come tomorrow. So three things: question number 1 from that, chart number 2, question number 1, then revise whatever we have done today, and after that chart number 5. Tomorrow, as I told you, we will complete till chart number 5, and thereafter, when the next lecture, when I start on house property, that house property, students, I'm going to start with the this one. House property, when I'm going to start, I'm also going to use the module for the question answers. The heads of income, I'll also touch upon your modules. For the heads of income, students, I'm also going to touch upon your modules for practical questions and all. Okay, so that you have a good base as well. So, students, this is what it would be. Yes, this is what it would be. So, students, just do whatever has been done. Nishank is asking, is module sufficient? More than sufficient. Your module is really very good. And the charts for revision. Module plus the charts for revision. Nothing more, nothing less. Why the charts for revision? Because it will be so handy. Even in final CA, students, I am preparing these charts. These charts, students, are so handy to revise. Whenever you have got half an hour, you can just go through a couple of charts and you are done with one topic. And you will never know that you are revising income tax without revising income tax. Like without sitting for income tax as a day, you are revising very frequently. This is the magic of all these charts. which you have prepared so comprehensively, and you'll also will realize everything has been covered. So students, see you then. Please do your stuff well. Okay, and I'll see you in the tomorrow's session. I think same 9:30, 9:40, between that I'll start, depending upon when the previous session is over. So 9:30, 9:40, between that time in the morning I'll start. Fine students, and I'll see you then tomorrow. Please revise it and be prepared for tomorrow's session. Thank you.